Going live.
Hey, I thought I was going to get a 2-minute break.
you didn't get any 2-minute break. Oh, now we're on the next one.
Are we live?
Yep, you're live.
We're live. Now we're on to part two of our healthy pizza stream. Now we're moving on to our unhealthy pizza stream and dance party. Nope. So welcome in, everyone who is just finding our new stream. I'm in the middle of sauteing up some veggies to go on this new pizza.
Let's share.
And I gotta find the stream there. All right.
Oh, what's this?
Without burning.
How do I do this?
Without burning all my food.
I think I just copied. Okay.
See you
copy
all.
Copy link.
Come on over, says Stacy.
No.
All right. Come on over. Fun Food Friday, healthy pizza. Oh boy. I think that, was it still live? Are we still live? The old one's still live.
It is? No, it isn't.
Oh, no, it's not. Okay, we're good. All right. Let's see if I got a notification.
It's a great thumbnail.
All right. Oh, there it is.
Thanks,
I found
Mike, for
it. I found
providing
it.
Providing the thumbnail.
Ooh, you guys found it. You guys are fast.
I love it.
Already got 8 likes. Wait. Am I on the right stream? Yep, I am.
I hope you are.
Welcome back, you guys. All right. So we got our veggies all sauteed here that we're going to put on this pizza.
Oh, let me see here.
This is Michelle's creation. That's what this one's called. I can even put real meat on this one because we actually have pepperoni. Whoop, whoop.
Yes.
Yeah. Michelle's creation. Now it's the dance party and work off all those pizza calories. Open the door. All right, welcome in. Anybody who's just new or coming back. I'm remembering something that has to go on here. Parmesan. We'll put Parmesan. Oh, pepperoni. Pepperoni. Look, I found olives. Yes, olives. Now it's more like clean out the refrigerator time. Welcome back in, you guys. I see some familiar faces in there. Okay. This part. Kids don't like olives. But I like olives. Garrett likes olives. Look, Garrett, what I found for the pizza. Look what I'm putting on there. Did you see a garm? Something. This is in the way. You guys don't want to stare at that. All right. All right. Are you guys dancing out there? I know it's a little late for you. All right. We're putting olives on here. olives. Oh, I think they were supposed to go after the cheese, but oh well. Gabe, the dance party's starting. All right. Olives, cheese, pepperoni. I'm doing Monterey Jack because we don't have mozzarella. I'm making more pizza with, like I said, real cheese. This is a real cheese pizza. It's like not fake cheese. And pepperoni. We got pepperoni, woo! That makes everything taste better. All right, here we go. Pepperoni, pizza with cheese and meat. Yeah! You ready for this one, Gabe? This one won't last long. Hey, Shelly, welcome in.
Hey, Shelly.
Russ is doing the worm. What's that?
He's done the worm.
What's the worm?
Yeah.
Is this the worm? Or is it this the worm? That's the wave. All right. Show me your moves. Hang on. I should put this, like, what can we do with this? Okay, get out of there. It summoned Shelly. So, for you guys who were just joining, who weren't here for the earlier stream, Russ kind of had the pizza that was the most favorite. So, he won with the healthy pizza. The one on my recipe was okay. Not the favorite. I don't like this container at all. Terrible pickle container. Alright, I got my timer on, so I'm not gonna burn anything. Oh, he's doing the worm with his finger? Is that what he's doing? Alright, I gotta find a container that opens. It even has like grape leaves. It even has grape leaves in there. Those are pickles, but The lid doesn't stay on that pickle container.
You know you make me wanna kick my heels up and down.
All right, it's Friday. You will. It's happy hour at the Monarch.
All right, welcome all in. Mikey, Jonathan, Pam, Ross.
You will.
Oh, good.
Pam thinks our neighbors hate Fun Food Friday. I wonder if they wonder, like, what goes on in there?
Hey, gratitude.
Oh, okay, gratitude. Hang on, I gotta check my pizza. I'll read this in just a sec.
No, it looks fun. It's gonna cook longer. Go ahead.
It's gonna cook longer, yeah, but I don't want to forget it. Oh no, I hit the timer. What did I do? Oh, hang on. Start. And then timer.
500.
Yeah, it's been at 500. Okay. Okay, can I read this while they're this? Okay. Gratitude. I climb up a mountain. Okay, this is from Chicken Soup for the Body and Soul. All right, and just remind me that my pizza is so it doesn't burn. Okay. I climb up a mountain to breathe in the air. I leave behind with each step one more useless care. The sun ripples like laughter across the wide sea. I smile at a flower and it smiles back at me. The wind lifts a scent from the meadow below and reminds me of the first girl I kissed long ago. I kneel in the heather, feel my spirit expand. A bright butterfly stops to rest on my hand. The clouds ever present, yet no two the same, give the lively imaginations a game. Look, a sailboat, a rabbit, an angel, a swan. And it's the best kind of game because no one's ever wrong. Everyone should have a secret place like my hill, just to rest and let the mind roam free where it will. Far away from traffic, noise, and the dust, in the crystal clear sunshine of a world they can trust. Walk gently with, turn your heart to the beauty that's in and around you. Walk gently with love and the same will surround you. You will surely see further the farther you go. And remember, it's pain which helps us to grow. For with all its sadness, its heartache and strife, with all of its sorrow, it's a wonderful life. Yes, with all of its sorrow, it's a wonderful life. Mark Rickabry. That kind of reminds me of a mix between Dr. Seuss and the movie. It's a Wonderful Life. What do you guys think? It's true. That's like the whole thing about the monarch butterfly. It's the struggle that makes you stronger. And we can't grow if we don't have those struggles. We can't get stronger. Sometimes we need that pain to appreciate when we don't have the pain. So hang on, my pizza's coming out. Don't wanna burn it. Where'd my glove go? Where's the glove? The glove. Oh, here it is. I set off the fire alarm. I think my pizza's ready. You're off and on your way. Off and you go. Yes, Pam. That Dr. Seuss. Get rid of this. Music. like cleaning music, right? I did not know the words to this song.
Really? I guess.
I do not know those. Footloose. There we go. That's not so bad to look at her. Never a dull moment. Done now. I pulled it out, Mikey.
Don't touch it, hot. Hot, hot, hot.
Hey Glenn, welcome in. Have fun, don't we track. Ooh, I got my new piece. Gotta do something with this dough.
Hang on.
What do I do? Immediately.
Turn that down a little bit.
This one?
No, that.
Oh, okay.
Put that down.
Okay.
And read that.
Okay, next. Next one. All right. So this one is again from Chicken Soup to inspire the body and soul. There is, okay, this is called One Price. Please,
it's not hot.
I'll give it to you in a minute, so don't touch. There is one, my sister Reed, well, that's going?
Reed.
Okay, there is only one price. You pay for this experience with your life. You can paint on a canvas 1 inch square. You can paint on a canvas 1 mile square or any size or shape in between. The price is the same. One life, due and payable. One payment in full at the end. And you die knowing the scope of your choice. Timid or expansive. Cramped or capacious. Listen to me. One price. One price buys all the rides. Or none. The price is one life. Spectator or player. In or out of the arena, one life. Time is the only unknown. And time matters not. The price of admission. For 1 minute or for one eternity remains one life. Hoarding adds not 1 second. Giving subtracts not 1 breath. Living itself is the defining action, the shaping force, brave, fierce, living. In the body, heart open, arms wide, eyes open. The act of being shapes and sizes the canvas. Carpe diem. Not nearly enough. Seize life. Was that Semper Fi? I don't know that. Maybe that's not it. Okay.
What?
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
Sorry. Right. Ring from it the payment's worth. Spread out. Unfold. Stretch wide. Paint in broad strokes with bright colors. Man or mouse. A line or a 6-lane freeway. Gray or a rainbow, a point or a universe. Dance on a pinhead or across the stars. The price remains the same. One life. Roberta R. Dean.
Do you think we can make one big num-num cookie out of that?
Those aren't cookies. Those are dough.
Well, can you make one?
That's dough.
Can you make a cookie out of that?
All right. Break time. Okay. Pizza, we're gonna put, I'm gonna put a little bit of arugula on mine. Pizza time! With the real stuff. No, I'm gonna put it with this. Put that back. Watch your fingers. Hold on. Maybe I'll do one piece at a time. Watch out.
Can I take one piece?
Watch out. Hold on. Wait. I got one left. No, two more. Wait. All right, take it. Hot. Here.
Now we get a bite,
Sorry, it's a pink plate. There you go. I'm gonna put arugula on mine. We can turn that off. Nobody loves you. Do you want some more? Another piece of pizza?
Maybe, Eric. Hey, Eric. Welcome in.
Hi, Eric. right.
That's it.
Can I have some milk, please?
Milk, sure. That's it for the pizza.
Yeah, morning milk.
Not right now. I don't have morning milk. You have to just have this. There you go.
That is really
tough. Yes, it is. Here, I'll slide you over.
I don't know about that, Eric, but we'll see. We're going to test it out. This is the unhealthy one. We did the stream earlier with the healthy pizza. Ditch the green stuff. Oh, wow. I'm glad you're feeling better, Eric. Evan Mitt. Supposed to do with my dough. I have two big dough balls here. Oh, okay. This one I'm gonna read. All right, you ready? Whoever finds this, I love you. On a quiet street in the city, a little old man walked along, shuffling through the autumn afternoon. The autumn leaves reminded him of the other summers come and gone. He had a long, lonely night ahead, waiting for June. Then among the leaves near an orphan's home, a piece of paper caught his eye, and he stopped to pick it up with trembling hands. As he read the childish writing, the old man began to cry, because the words burned inside him like a brand. Whoever finds this, I love you. Whoever finds this, I need you. I ain't even got no one to talk to. So whoever finds this, I love you. The old man's eyes searched the orphan's home, and came to rest upon a child, with her nose pressed up against the window pane. And the old man knew he'd found a friend at last, so he waved to her and smiled. And they both knew they'd spend the winter laughing at the rain. And they did spend the winter laughing at the rain, talking through the fence and exchanging little gifts they had made for each other. The old man would carve toys for the little girl. She would draw pictures for him of beautiful ladies. surrounded by green trees and sunshine, and they laughed a lot. But then, on the first day of June, the little girl ran to the fence to show the old man a picture she drew, but he wasn't there. And somehow the little girl knew he wasn't coming back. So she went to her room, took a crayon and paper, and wrote, "Whoever finds this, I love you. Whoever finds this, I need you. I ain't even got no one to talk to. So whoever finds this, I love you. Author unknown." Wow. That was a sweet story. Moving on. I like the version of this they used for the late year trailer.
Okay, so
break out another cold brew. Are you dancing with me? I gotta figure out what to do with my dough. Maybe you guys can help me. I still have dough left. Do I just wrap it up and put it in the freezer? Try to read my directions.
This.
The day after serving, remove the dough from the containers, place it on the
There's no exception to the rule. Listen, baby.
Just immediately have
maybe factual, maybe cruel.
I'm lying.
Everybody plays a fool. Ooh. Falling in love is such an easy thing to do.
How do I freeze this?
And there's no guarantee that the one you love is gonna love you.
I'm gonna have to Google that. I don't know what to do with my dough.
Anybody could be that guy.
pretzels. Really, you had to put Pam on your spray shovel, or your spray it on your shovel. Holy moly! So okay, lots of advice on my dough. Thank you. So I have to let it rise. Like, how do I know if it's all the way risen? I thought it was risen because, I don't know. It's quite big, so it's been rising all this time. Do I punch it down and let it rise again? Not quite sure. Okay. Oh, flatbread dough. It has yeast in it though, Russ, so it is like bread dough, kind of, because it's yeasty. But anyway, I'm going to read you another story. So no tissues needed this time, I guess. I'm going to guess. All right. So this is Almy Rose. It was at least 2 months before Christmas when 9-year-old Almy Rose told her father and me that she wanted a new bicycle. Her old Barbie bicycle was just too babyish, and besides, it needed a new tire. As Christmas drew nearer, her desire for a bicycle seemed to fade, or so we thought, and she didn't mention it again. Merrily, we started purchasing the latest rage, Babysitter's Club dolls, and beautiful storybooks, a dollhouse, a holiday dress, and toys. Then, much to our surprise, on December 23rd, she proudly announced that she really wanted a bike more than anything else. Now, we didn't know what to do. It was just too late, with all of the details of preparing Christmas dinner and buying last-minute gifts, to take time to select the right bike for our little girl. So here we were, Christmas Eve around 9 p.m., having just returned from one wonderful party, contemplating our evening ahead, hours of wrapping children's presents, parents' presents, a brother's present, and friends' presents. With Almy Rose and her 6-year-old brother Dylan nestled snug in their beds, we could now think only of the bicycle, the guilt, and the idea that we were parents who would disappoint their child. That's when my husband Ron was inspired. What if I make a little bicycle out of clay and write a note that she could trade the clay model in for a real bike? The theory, of course, being that since it's a high-ticket item and she is such a big girl, it would be much better for her to pick it out herself. So he spent the next 5 hours painstakingly working with clay to create a miniature bike. 3 hours later on Christmas morning, that's not much sleep, we were so excited for Almy Rose to open the little heart-shaped package with the beautiful red and white clay bike and the note. Finally, she opened and read the note out loud. She looked at me and then at Ron and said, "So does this mean that I trade in this bike that Daddy made for me for a real one?" Beaming, I said, "Yes." Almy Rose had tears in her eyes when she replied, "I could never trade in this beautiful bicycle that Dad made for me. That Daddy made for me. I'd rather keep this than get a real bike." At that moment, we would have moved heaven and earth to buy her every bicycle on the planet. That's from Michelle Lawrence. Isn't that sweet? It's not always what you think it is, and you don't always know exactly what your kids want, but I know parents always want to do the best at Christmas and give them what they want, but how sweet that she really appreciated how much her dad worked on that little miniature bicycle, so much that she wanted to keep it and knew that was something special he made for her. So that's a really cute story. All right. She said no tears, you're not
when
supposed to
this
cry.
Whole world starts me down,
this isn't my kind of music.
Are just
that's all right.
Too much.
Where's the dance music?
I'll climb way up to the top of the stairs.
and all my cares just drift right into space. On the roof, it's peaceful as can be.
Come on.
afterwards. It's like exercise class. My neck's super tight. Is this Jeremiah's a Bullfrog? My mom loved this song. She wanted it at her funeral.
He was a good friend of mine.
Stretches, shoulder circles. Oh, I'm gonna read something else. Grab those tissues. Oh, I'm lower now, so I better move this over here so you can hear me.
Oh, they can hear me.
You can hear me. I'm loud enough. I don't need the microphone. All right. Oh, well, this doesn't necessarily pertain to me, but okay. It says, when we're alone, we can dance. The little cruise ship was crowded with people, many of them retired, all of them off for 3 days of pleasure. Ahead of me in the carpeted passageway was a tiny woman in a brown polyester slacks, her shoulders hunched and her white hair cut in a short straight bob. From the ship's intercom came a familiar tune, Begin the Beguine, I don't know what that is, by Artie Shaw. And suddenly a wonderful thing happened. The woman, unaware that anyone was behind her, began to shimmy and shake. She snapped her fingers, she swiveled her hips, she did a quick and graceful Lindy step, back, shuffle, side. Then, as she reached the door to the dining room, she paused, assembled her dignity, and stepped soberly through. She became a hunched old lady again. That visual fragment has returned to my mind many times. I think of it now as I reach another birthday, and at an age where most people would not believe that I still shimmy too. Younger people think folks my years are beyond music, romance, dancing, or dreams. They see us as age has shaped us, camouflaged by wrinkles with thick waist and graying hair. They don't see all the people who live inside. We present a certain face to the world because custom dictates it. We are the wise old codgers, the dignified matrons. We have no leeway to act out other selves or use our other lives. No one would ever know, for instance, that I am still the skinny girl who grew up in a leafy suburb of Boston. Inside, I still think of myself as the youngest of four children in a vivacious family, headed by a mother of great beauty and a dad of unfailing good cheer. It doesn't matter that my parents are long gone and that the four children are now three. I am still the faintly snobbish child accustomed to long cars and maids, though my dad lost his money in the Depression, and I live these days from paycheck to paycheck. Beth Ashley. That kind of reminds me of my mom, the one like shimmying, except she would just shimmy right on into the dining room. Right, honey?
Mm-hmm.
Shimmy and shake. Yep. She liked to liven things up, that's for sure.
Sure, it's nice to open a gift that's tied up with a perfect bow. But the greatest present of all was given to me.
Did you go brush your teeth?
Long ago.
Did you go brush your teeth?
It's something I would never trade. It's the family that we've made. 'Cause when we're together, I have everything on my list. And when we're together,
Snuggler.
Yeah.
you're sweet. Don't let nobody touch it unless that somebody's me. I'm gonna be a man, there ain't no other way. Cause girl, you're hotter than a Southern California day.
Hey Chris, Thunder Chris. Welcome in.
Hey Chris, welcome in to the dance party. That feels so good when you're tight to stretch out those, So I got to tell you something funny. You know those Instagram reels? I saw the funniest one today, and it was about, somebody did one where they were singing a song in the car, and then like pretending they were singing it, and then there was like a car next to them, and then another girl saw her reel. And she put her reel up, so the two girls almost looked alike. And so she was singing the one part to the song, and then the girl in the other car was, like, singing the other part to the other song, but they didn't know each other. I don't even know how you explain it. So she was, like, singing the one, something about some Mac song or something. So she would, like, sing some words, and she's, like, singing like this. And then her title was when you pull up next to your soul sister at the stoplight, and she's jamming to the same song you're singing in your car or something like that. So anyway, so she's like doing her thing with her sunglasses on. And then the girl's like in the other car, like on this side of the screen. And she's like singing to the other girl. But anyway, enough of that. I get stuck. You get stuck reading those things or watching those. And then the next thing you know, it's like 15 minutes later and you haven't gotten anything done. So yeah, those are kind of bad. And I don't even know how they do that because I only know how to post a picture on Instagram. And I know how to post a picture on Facebook. I think I could maybe post like a short video on Instagram, less than 60 seconds, but I don't know how they get all fancy and like do all those videos and stuff. I guess that's a Garrett thing. I don't know. Garrett obviously does all the videos for our channel, all the editing. I know nothing. I know nothing. I don't even know like how to do all the fun stuff on social media. So there you have it. Hey Dennis, welcome in. Welcome, welcome. Welcoming Dad Builds. Let's see. What else is going on? So that's just my thing that I wanted to say. I just thought it was really funny because, you know, you see those things and you're just like, how did they do that? And then
Michelle seems like she's wired a little.
She put the filters on? The ones who...
this cold brew nitro thing.
Like 4 Mountain Dews, I guess, worth of caffeine. But anyway, they put those filters on and they put the one on where they have like the lip, where they plump up the lips and then they put the filter on and then they make a video. And they're like, I don't really look like this, but it looks like I just had my lips done or something. And I think that's kind of funny too.
Tell a funny story about your mom.
Tell them a funny story about my mom? Oh my gosh, there's so many funny stories. Well, okay, so I went to pick my mom up at the airport one time. You might have heard this one, might have not. Went to pick her up at the airport one time. She was coming back from Mexico, and she was already too old to be traveling to Mexico by herself, but I think she might have gone with a tour group. I'm not quite sure. And she comes off the plane, and keep in mind, she was probably in her 80s, okay? She gets off the plane, and her face is, like, all green and swollen, black and blue, stitched up, like, all over the place. And I'm like, what? What happened? And she's like, oh, I didn't want to tell you. She's like, I had a little fall in Mexico. And she goes, I guess she was walking and things aren't as safe down there or, you know, maybe as cautious. And there was a rebar sticking up out of the ground and she was walking and she tripped over it and it like stabbed her in the face. She fell on it and like smashed her teeth and it like stabbed her in the face. So she had to go to the hospital and they had to like stitch her up.
That's a funny story.
Well, it's a funny story because she gets off the airplane.
Wow.
She gets off the airplane and she tells me the story and she goes, yeah.
This is my mom. A horrifying story.
No, this is my mom. So she gets on the airplane and everybody's like, oh man, like what happened to you? She's like, you know what I told everybody on the plane? She goes, I told them I went to Mexico for a facelift for plastic surgery and it went really bad. And she didn't even tell any of us, like, when she was down there that she fell and got hurt like that. And then here she comes off that plane and she's just, like, all swollen and black and blue with, like, all these stitches. So she told everybody, like, don't go there for a facelift because it didn't go very well. I'm just like, oh, she's always, like, full of jokes. But anyways, so that's mom. Gotta love her. Rest her soul. God rest her soul. It'll be, what, 2 years in March. And actually, I just realized yesterday, not to be Debbie Downer, but yesterday was the 6th anniversary. My sister passed away 6 years ago. It was yesterday. 6 years ago yesterday was
Funny about your sister.
My family has lots of funny stories. So my sister, we used to go on these trips up to Lake Elmenor, do like a girls weekend with like all her mom friends and stuff, but she would always let me come along. And by then I was older, like, you know, I was in my 20s, but I would go hang out with all of them and we would all ride up like in a car together. And we made a stop at this McDonald's, and my sister was disabled. She had MS, multiple sclerosis. And so she, at the time we were going up there, she had a walker. She wasn't to the point where she was totally
wheeled. Slow your speech down just a tad.
Oh.
I know that caffeine.
Mike's probably having a hard time. So she was disabled. And so she wasn't in a wheelchair yet. Which she had gotten to, but she was still in her walker. So we stopped at McDonald's and we went into the bathroom and I don't know, you might not think this, I mean, Garrett's probably not going to think it's a funny story, but we were in the bathroom and I don't know what happened, but she was like leaning because she couldn't get off her walker. She was like leaning on the sink and the whole sink broke off the wall. Oh my gosh. Like, I mean, it's not really that, it's not really that funny, but when it happens to you, you're like, oh my gosh, like, did that just happen? Like, oh no, like what happened? So of course we like told them, we're like, oh no, you know, she was like, you know, hanging on to it because she, you know, had her walker and the whole thing fell. Nobody got hurt. But it's like one of those stories that we'll never forget. We're like, you remember when we went to the McDonald's and we stopped for the rest stop and Mary Jo knocked the sink off the wall? So it's like, anyway, one of those things that you like you don't forget. So we always had funny stories like that. Oh, good night, Stacy. Good night, good night. Hey, Jeffrey, welcome in. Okay, Anne thinks it's funny. Hi, Anne, welcome in.
About another story about your sister.
Oh my gosh. Let's see. Before they merged Instagram TVs, now you just upload your long videos while going to Instagram. Okay, I'm looking here. The first time my brother-in-law met my grandma, she had hives from a reaction to medicine. She asked him if he wanted to see her hives, and he thinks he's going to roll up her sleeves, so said yes. Yes. She stands up, bends over, and pulls her pants and pantyhose down, and then... Oh my gosh. Oh gosh. The hives were like on her legs or on her butt or something. Oh my gosh. That's so funny, Pam. Holy moly. He got more than he was expecting. Holy moly. Yeah. I had another, Garrett's like another funny story of my sister. I don't know. Gosh. It's hard when you're like, when you're caught off guard, but I just remember that was like the Lake Elmenor story. I know another time she did something. She got lost or she was crawling around. I don't know. Can't remember. Laker is a big fan. Anne says that was a funny story to come in on. glad you liked that. So that was that story. Yeah, my mom and my sister, they were both always kind of characters. Trying to think if there's a story of them, something they funny they did together. But I can't think of one off the top of my head. What's that?
What was it about your sister that you loved?
Oh, what was it about my sister that I loved? You know what I loved about my sister is that, I mean, from my perspective, I thought that she was always very, I don't know how you say, like, kind, loving. Like, I feel like she didn't have a mean bone in her body. Like, she was kind to, like, everybody. Like, she couldn't even, I don't even think she could ever really be mean or say, like, really mean things about anybody. She just always had kind words to say and was always just so genuine. You know, it wasn't fake. Like, she didn't, like, fake pretend to like people. She always found something to like, I think, about everybody. And because of that, she had a lot of friends. Like, she had a lot of people that really enjoyed being around her. She always was such, she was, like, the best sister anybody could even ever want because she, I was, like, her little sister. She's, like, 15 years older than I was. And, you know, when I was born, she was just, you know, in high school, kind of, like, almost, you know, almost, well, she was, like, halfway through high school by the time that I was born. And, but she always, like, took time to babysit me and, you know, she did a lot and helped me out a lot. And she was always really excited to do it. So that was something that I always appreciated. And I remember, like, going to visit her in college. Like, my mom took her up, me up there. And when I was little, and I know all the, it was like a big, not a big college, but it was like an old college, I guess. And so their dorm room had these huge dressers. And I remember them putting me in the dresser drawer. Like, the girls all thought it was, like, so funny that they put all the clothes and, like, blankets in there. And then they put Mary Jo's little sister in the dresser drawer. And it's kind of funny, the things that you remember when you're a kid, because there's a lot of things you don't remember. It's like when you think about your childhood, sometimes you kind of, like, blank out, like you don't remember anything from, like, when you were a year old. So I think it's always kind of fun to think back at some of the things that I remember. I don't know about you guys. Tomorrow, yes, tomorrow's Saturday. I still have to fix the bathroom. That's, like, a whole nother project. But anyway, yeah, so it was kind of reminiscent about my sister. And, you know, you always miss people that aren't around anymore. A lot of times you see something or you something happens and you're like, oh, I gotta tell so and so, and then you remember that they're not there. And I think that's when it hurts a lot, because you just feel like you can't you can't share that stuff with them anymore. But I'm sure they're up there somewhere knowing and watching what's going on, and we'll see each other again someday. So
your father.
My dad.
Tell something about your father.
Same kind of thing. My dad and my sister were a lot alike. My dad passed away when I was 15, so I didn't have a long life with him, but it felt like eternity. Like, it felt like obviously I've known him my whole life, even though I've only known him, like, probably a quarter of my life. But he was amazing. He just made me feel, I remember I tell Garrett, when I was a little kid, probably only in kindergarten, maybe not even that old, he used to carry me up and down the stairs, and he would be like, who's the prettiest girl in the whole wide world? And then he's like, Michelle is. But he would say, like, my whole name. He's like, Michelle da 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 is. And he would go, like, up and down the stairs, who's the prettiest girl in the whole wide world? So they kind of, he, like, brainwashed me when I was little. But I was very much a daddy's girl. And he got sick because he'd had a heart attack right after I was born. And so he had a bad heart. And because of that, he couldn't do a lot of physical things. Like, a lot of dads would play baseball and stuff with their kids, and my dad couldn't do a lot of physical stuff. In fact, he ended up retiring early and couldn't work anymore. And so he was almost like a stay-at-home dad when I was, like, older, kind of around the time that he passed away. And he still had his hobbies, and his hobbies were kind of physical. Like, he went smelting, if you know what that is, where you go out into, like, a creek. And you wear hip boots, so you go wear these waders way out into the water, and the water is kind of rushing, and so it's kind of a lot of strength to, like, keep your footing and stand up, and then you scoop up the fish as they're, you know, going up the stream. So my mom, and you do it at nighttime because it's when it's dark is when the smelt would go go up the stream. And so my mom always sent me with my dad on his hobbies. So he did fishing, smelting, and hunting. Which Frankie's a hunter, so that's where I got my hunting background, was from my dad. So she would send me as, like, the babysitter to make sure if something happened to him that I could go get help. So because of that, we had, like, a really, really close bond. And I learned to do like all of his hobbies too. So you didn't know. Hey, King B, welcome in. How's it going? So part of the brainwashing. No. He can remember my full name. I'm just not gonna say it on the stream. But he would like take me up and down the stairs, and he's like, hey, you know, who's the most beautiful girl in the world, and just very again, like another kind soul. He had a lot of friends, and he was always really kind and always wanting to help out, you know, taking in stray animals. He had that heart for animals and things like that, even though he was a hunter. And he was also a gardener, which is really funny because my mom was not a cook. Now you can see where I get that from. She was also not a gardener or too much of a sewer. My dad knew how to sew. My dad knew how to cook, and my dad knew how to clean, and he also knew how to garden. And he got all those skills in the Navy, believe it or not, because he was in the Navy in Pearl Harbor the day it was bombed. I told you guys that, I think, on Pearl Harbor Day. He was on the USS Whitney, which was a destroyer tender in Pearl Harbor. So I got a lot of firsthand stories about what he saw and the horrors that he saw and all that kind of stuff in Pearl Harbor. But so one thing I found amazing. So he learned how to clean because, you know, being in the Navy, you know, everything's like meticulous and you got to, you know, take care of your things and your area. And so he did a little bit better.
Any after effects from that?
What?
The war? The bodies in the ocean.
The only after effect that I ever noticed, like, from him as far as, like, you know, like PTSD or anything like that, was he could not watch Tora, the movie, because he would have, you know, it would give him strong flashback reactions to that.
But how do you think he dealt with it?
Well, he didn't have an easy upbringing. He was very poor and he had a huge family. And, you know, growing up, he had to share a bed with like five brothers and sisters in one bed, like a big, you know, it was like one big bed. And he said, you know, every year, like mom would announce like, oh, there's some new baby, you know, we have a new family member or whatever, cause she'd have a new baby. And they never knew until the baby arrived. So, there was a lot of mouths to feed. And, because of that, I think he had a really tough upbringing, and all of his brothers and sisters like served in the military during the war, and and he went in at 17. He went in when he was young, and actually I think he was about 17 when all that happened. So that's only a few years older than Hannah. That's tough, but he dealt with it really well. But I think they were very mentally tough back then because, you know, they went through rationing food and, you know, not having, you know, enough things to go on the table. And I know my mom was saying, you know, my mom even went to work in the factory at Morris Chain to make the parts for the tanks. You know, when the men were at war, the women took over a lot of the jobs that the men had. So I just think that they had, you know, they're very mentally tough. And so a lot of things didn't really bother him too much other than, like I said, that watching that movie. So, but I think, you know, obviously being in the Navy and living on a ship and living in a family with like a lot of people, I think helps develop your personal relationship skills, I think, because you have to figure out how to maneuver around in that kind of social situation. Whereas if you're, you know, isolated or a single child or, you know, don't have a big family, you don't have to do that. And the same in the military, you're with, you know, in close quarters, especially in the Navy on a ship, you're in close quarters with people and you really have no choice but to figure out, get along. Otherwise it's going to be miserable. So you really just have to tough it out, get along, and you don't have a choice to run away from problems. So I think it gives you good problem solving skills. And my dad had a very good work ethic. So, you know, he was a hard worker. He actually worked like two jobs. He would work, you know, all day, and then he would do like things at night. Like he was an electrician. So he would do, kind of side jobs for people. And I know he did, before I was born, he volunteered like a firefighter, like volunteered at the fire department and things like that. So he wasn't home a lot, but he did, like I said, he was a good gardener and he liked to make his own homemade sausage. And he had a garden. And at that time, I never appreciated it because I was a kid and I hated vegetables. He would grow probably like the best like homegrown tomatoes, like the beefsteak tomatoes and cucumbers and carrots and, lettuce. And he would bring it in and I was like, ugh, you know, I don't want to try it. No, I don't like vegetables. But now I'm like, man, what I was missing, like all those years, I could have had all that good food from the garden. So anyway, that's a little bit about my family. And
what about your dogs? Stoli, come on, you got to tell about Stoli.
Oh, my dog Stoli. Well, Stoli, he was my, well, my dog, Stoli was the first dog that I had, like, being, you know, like, outside of, like, my family or, you know, like, a family dog from my parents or something. And so my first marriage, when I was married, I don't even know if we were, like, I don't think we were, like, talking about getting a dog, but I remember the doorbell ringing one day. And I know I complained to my husband that he wasn't home, like, as much as I would like him to be home, I think. Like, he was always out a lot of times at night. And I'd be like, you know, you're not home, and I'm lonely, and I like to have a lot of people around me. And so one day in the afternoon, I remember the doorbell rang, and I opened the door, and there was this little puppy sitting on the doorstep, and he was just, like, looking up at me. He was only, like, probably 8 weeks old, and it was our dog Stoli, who was a purebred Queensland heeler. And my husband had gone, like, all the way to Tracy, or gone far away to actually get him from, like, a breeder. And, good night, Pam. so anyway, he was there at the door, and he
good
said,
night, Pam.
This way.
We love you too.
He said, this dog, you know, I got you a dog, so now you'll never be alone. Like, you'll always have this dog. If I can't be with you, you know, you always have Stoli here with you. So we had Stoli for, I want to say, how old was he when he passed away? 18, 17, like that? 17 years? We had him a long time. 17. He was like 17. And during those years, my husband passed away. The first one who got Stoli for us, he was killed in a car accident. And
at least that's what she told me.
I didn't kill him with my cooking. It was not that. So, yes, he was
killed in a car. They
never found the body. It was so bad. So... I always still had Stoli with me. Like, you know, after he died, I was like, oh, well, I still have, you know, like a piece of him with me. I still have Stoli. And then by then I'd had two dogs, Stoli and Taz. But he was just the smartest dog. Like when he was 8 weeks old, like when he came to our house, within a couple weeks, he knew, those dogs are really, really smart. He knew all of his toys by name. Like he had like a noisy toy. He had like a rope, ball, like whatever toy it was. He would be like, Stoli, go get your noisy toy or go get your rope. And he would, like, go and get it and, like, be all proud and bring it back. And he was just, like, this tiny little puppy. He was just so smart, like, knew everything. And he lived for 17 years. And he got to be real ornery. Like, as he got older, he didn't like people too much. Like, he didn't like a lot of people. So he was kind of like, oh. And that's that type of breed of dog. They're not all like that, but they are kind of very single-person dog or single-family dog. So they don't like a lot of strangers. He would not let strangers come in the house. He would growl.
My friend John.
About
Stoli and him. You wanted to go pet him. In your garage.
In my garage. I'm trying to think. Somebody.
Christie's John.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, he just didn't like a lot of people. So when it was kind of like anybody. But yeah, my friend's husband like came up to pet him. And I think he nipped at it. He nipped him, right? Didn't he bite him in the hand? I don't remember the story. I just know he bit him in the hand. I don't remember the story. He bit him in the hand or something, right? He nipped at him.
Wow.
I don't remember. Because he kind of nipped at a lot of people.
Oh, gosh. Don't lose your memory. You told me the story.
I don't remember.
Yeah.
Thanks, my backyard science.
He wanted to pet your Stoli. He told him, that's not a good idea.
Remember? Oh, and he's like, all dogs like me? Is that all dogs like me. And then he reached out, and Stoli was like, I don't like you. And I'm like, I told you not to pet him.
And then he comes back, and your dog bit me.
Yeah,
I told you not to go out there.
Told you not to go pet him. So, yeah. But anyway, so, yeah. So Stoli, he was quite a character. He was very ornery, but he was very, very protective, like, of the family and stuff like that. And very smart, so...
Yeah, you know, some people, I only met my grandmother, but both passed away when I was 4 and 5.
Yeah, fifth grade, same fourth here, and yeah.
And then yeah. I think Elena, I know, had a good good relationship with her grandparents. So, I think that's the cool thing about sharing stories too. You and why you share stories with people. I mean, you could share a lot of things, but I think sometimes, yeah, it's good to have fun, but it's also good, I think, to share stories about each other or family. And some you know, some people had grandparents, some people probably didn't have good grandparents. Some people, like me, most of my grandparents were gone.
Yeah.
And the one grandparent mother I did have who was still alive, she couldn't speak English. So, and they didn't teach us Japanese, you know, because of the history of what happened to them. Not like the other, like Asian cultures that immigrated over here, who would tend to teach their kids. There's a reason they didn't teach us. They were afraid we would get, you know, interned into a camp to it because of our nationality. So I think a lot of it, they try to Americanize us, you know, make us more Caucasian, you know, in a lot of ways. So, you know, those are things, you know, the stories that we have.
Even with the names, right? Like, that's why.
Yeah, you know, I think there's probably something to that, you know. And some of it, I think it was just trying to, you know, adjust to the country. But yeah, all these things, you know, the stories we have that we share with each other. You know, those are the things that can evoke really good memories, or just memories in general.
Well, and that's the same thing.
Reminisce.
That's the same thing with my family's story, is that, like, Garrett, we were both born late in life to our parents, which is funny because then we had kids late in life, which is why my mom was like, my mom would have been 98 today. My mom would have been 98, like, recently. So I'm just like, wow. So she was a lot older when she had me. And because of that, our grandparents were all gone by the time we were born, except for one of mine and one of Garrett's, I think. So, like Garrett said, his grandma didn't speak English, and my grandpa was only alive. It was my mom's dad, and he was kind of a hoot like my mom was. He was only alive probably for like 4 years or 5 years, and then, you know, he passed away when I was still really young. So I never really got to meet my grandparents, but I did also hear stories. And my mom's mom passed away when she was really young. Like, my grandma died at 52, I think, from an aneurysm, like a brain aneurysm. So, but my mom always had stories too about that, because my grandma ran a boarding house, like, up at Cornell University in New York at the college. So she ran a boarding house for all the students. And my mom, obviously, like, my mom lived there because it was their home, but they also boarded the students that went to school. And my mom always told me stories how the students would get on the phone. And back then they only had like the one phone in the house. And my mom's, she's like, oh yeah. She's like, I used to get on the extension and like listen when all the students were on their phone calls because they were so interesting. I was like, Mom. She's like, yeah. And they could hear me breathing. They're like, I know you're on the phone. So obviously I followed in Mom's footsteps with that later on. All right. One last story for you. I don't know if you need tissues or not, but you could have them ready. All right, this is called...
Stop saying that. You get into it. You perseverate. It's a brain injury thing.
Okay, I'll stop.
You don't
stop.
Have to say that every time.
Tears and laughter. Well, that's all. I'm just reading what it says. Every child is born with the message that God is not yet discouraged of man. Through misted eyes, I gazed at my little son as if for the first time, and perhaps for the last time. He lay sedated, fighting for his life, with two holes in his heart and pneumonia. Doctors questioned whether my two-month-old baby with Down syndrome would live. I wanted to remember what it felt like to be his mother. I wanted to savor my inability to distinguish where my flesh ended and his began. As I softly pressed my cheek against his, our connection calmed my fears. I wanted to remember the wisp of curls that twirled behind his ears and the feeling of life fulfilled when his almond-shaped eyes drifted to look into mine. Mostly, I wanted to remember the inexplicable warmth that filled my heart when I held him. I had dreamed of days when we might build sandcastles at the beach together. When Eric would sing songs, Eric would swing so high in the park that he felt like he was flying. And when he would play catch with his daddy and cuddle with me, I begged the doctors to keep him alive. I pleaded with the nurses to feed him more. And I prayed to a God that I didn't know well to let me keep my baby. After one special conversation with my husband, Bob, I came to realize that Eric's soul would choose whether to stay with us or to let his body go. We stood on either side of his cold metal hospital crib and told him we would stay with him, love him, and nurture him if he chose to stay with us. My mind trusted whatever his soul chose, but my heart ached with the hope that he would choose to stay. Meanwhile, desperate to remember what it was like to hold my baby when it might last only these two precious months, to remember every moment, I decided to write it all down so I could never forget anything. From that moment of resolve, words flooded my thoughts. I formulated chapters in my mind between conversations, phrases appeared as I slipped off to sleep, and whole pages might appear to me upon waking, while driving, or at Eric's bedside. During his second week on life support, I strode into the hospital, past the reception desk to the bank of elevators, all the while transmuting emotions into words, mixing hopes and prayers. I stood before the elevator doors and stared up at numbers blinking all too slowly. 5, 4, 3, 2, until the soft bell rang and the doors parted to reveal smiling grandparents, nurses, or orderlies from the pediatric ward. They passed within a few feet of me, but we were worlds apart. I entered and leaned against the cold wall, returning to my sanctuary of words as the elevator rose, and I then walked slowly down the long hall to the children's ward. Before Bob arrived, I whispered to my baby about plans for our book. It would be our secret. Then I remembered that I don't keep secrets, especially when opening up is essential, so I told my husband and some close friends as we gathered near Eric. I began writing that very evening at my kitchen table, occasionally turning to gaze upon the empty cradle in the living room, a reminder of my baby still in the hospital. It felt like a part of me had been pulled away. Eric triumphed through 6 weeks of life support. But over the next 2 years, he had numerous bouts of pneumonia, respiratory viruses, and digestive problems. He was dependent on a breathing tank for his oxygen. We always knew where our little guy crawled to by following the 50-foot oxygen tube that trailed from the breathing tank at the end of the hall, wound around the kitchen table and into the living room, and ended to attach to Eric's face, allowing the prongs to let purified air flow into his nasal passages. When he was 17 months old, the doctors told us it was time for Eric to have his heart repaired. They said, "He's as healthy as he can be under such conditions. If you wait much longer, it will be too late." But they couldn't guarantee that his fragile heart and weak lungs would make it through the grueling surgery. 48 hours later, I stood by his crib and gazed past the tubes and wires to his angelic face, looked down and watched as he opened his eyes and focused on me. His smile illuminated the room. I let out a cry of relief. I knew Eric was here to stay. Through it all, the writing has carried us through the recurring life support crises as Eric's legs dangled again and again over death's pier. I recorded every experience, every emergency and breakthrough, every painful moment, and every miracle as love carried us deeper into ourselves, peeling away our resistance and teaching us to rely on faith. Our son needed cardiologists, pediatric nurses, therapists, and specialists to repair his heart. We needed Eric to repair ours. Our lives were opened up to a degree I never knew existed. In the midst of these past years, I found myself sitting at the large table in the corner room of the Unity Center, where we held our up with downs meetings. I sat across from a brand new mom and dad, and she held her 1-month-old blonde-haired baby with Down syndrome protectively against her chest, while her husband wrung his hands in his lap. "We haven't told our parents yet," she said, my eyes fixed on the young father's face as she spoke. His tears never stopped. Then it came to me that my book should not be a secret from anyone because we have known great pain and found miraculous healing. It comes from Eric's heart and mine. And after more than 4 years, his valiant little heart beats stronger with each passing day we are given. Today, we can't keep our son out of the playground. It's either monkey bars or basketball, soccer, or t-ball. We've since built many a sandcastle together, discovered new parks and playgrounds, have taken turns reading and rereading his books. Yes, he's reading now. and we've pretended to be manatees in our swimming pool and have eaten too much popcorn at the circus. We have a special boy who lives a joyful life. Eric had his heart checked once a year, but his laughter washes away my fears. When I look into his bright eyes and feel the warmth of his bear hugs, I know his loving heart is going to be just fine, and so is mine. That was written by Kimberly Thompson. So. It makes you appreciate, you know, all that time, all the time you have to spend with your loved ones to really appreciate that, because you never know, you know, when they're going to be with you and when they're not going to be with you. But it also shows for her the power, I think, of, you know, the therapy that you can get also from writing about things, writing it down. I mean, sometimes it's better to write it down than to blurt it out to the whole world. Sometimes you got to get it off your chest, and maybe writing it down is a way that you can get it off your chest, but kind of keep it, you know, so everybody doesn't have to see it. And then you can decide, like she did, you know, maybe at some point you do want people to see it. Maybe it's something, you know, that you feel could help people by way of a book or a story or something like that. So it can be very therapeutic writing. Anyway, let's take our prayer requests. It's getting late, and we want to make sure we get your prayer requests in. So before we wrap things up, go ahead and type them in the comments, if you are in the chat, if there's anything you need prayers for. And if you don't want to put it in the chat, you can send it to me on Instagram at @mymonarchmoments. You can send it to Garrett at @_grapesoda65, or you can email us at mymonarchmoments@gmail.com. So any of those ways you can reach us. You don't have to wait till we're streaming to say hi or, you know, send any kind of prayer requests. You can do that anytime. Open my eyes. Yeah. Jonathan's like, so I followed mom's footsteps of phone spying. Yes, I did. Let's see. You tore down the apart. Over with more resumes. Job situation. All right. I got that, Russ.
I can see it now, I can see it now, your kingdom is here. Heaven's all around.
Yes, Ithaca. Oh yeah, Dennis, Ithaca College is there too. It is. Yep. That's my hometown. It's very lovely. Actually, another thing I don't appreciate until I'm gone. Its nickname is Ithaca is Gorgeous. But it's because it's so full of so many natural gorges that are carved out by the glaciers, like years and years, you know, thousands of years ago. The Finger Lakes were carved out by the glaciers that many years ago. And now it's like a nice, in the summer, actually, it's like a big wine growing region in like Seneca Lake and Cayuga Lake. They've got a lot of wineries and vineyards around there, which you don't really even care about when you're 10 or 5. And it's kind of, you know, little known. I think they're known for like their Riesling or their sweet, like white kind of grapes. So that was like one thing. And then I really do miss that there was so much, it did get a lot of rain. It does get rainy there. but it, because of that, it makes everything so green and lush and so pretty. And it makes those waterfalls, you know, and all those gorges that they have. And it's just full of so many different waterfalls. In fact, that's where my mom was always telling me where she learned how to swim, was in one of those waterfall areas. Yeah. Tina, she has a lot going on. Oh, sure. Yes. For Tina.
Hey, Matt. Welcome in.
Hey, not that Matterhorn. Matt, welcome in. And Brandon. Hi, guys. Brandon the Pinocchio. So don't forget, before you go anywhere, to smash that thumbs up button. We really appreciate it. And if you know anybody who might like our channel, feel free to share about it. Let them know to come check out Monarch Moments. And if anyone's out there watching Ninja that's just getting to know us, welcome in. I'm Michelle. And you know, feel free to check out our channel, subscribe, smash that notification bell so you'll know when we do go live. Sometimes we have pop-up streams. We do stream sometimes on we do stream Fridays, normally Sundays and Wednesdays, but this Sunday, not quite sure. We might have a pop-up rather than like our regular or scheduled one, or we might go somewhere. Not 100% sure yet. So anyway, yes, it was very hilly there, Dennis. Ithaca has a lot of hills. There's like West Hill, East Hill, and South Hill, and then there's, yeah, and then the North Hill would be the lake, so there's no hill there. That's why there is no North Hill. So it's East, West, and East Hill has the college, Cornell. South Hill has Ithaca College, and then West Hill, more like residential. So, and she's graduated to the next program in monitoring. Oh, that's great news, My Backyard Science. We love to hear like praise reports or like feedback from how the prayers are going. So that's good news. We like to hear that. For Tina. Okay. The Disney Cruise Line open. Yeah, I don't know. I just pray for all the sick people right now. There's a lot of people getting sick, and got a basal skin cell cancer. Oh, okay. Well, you know what? I'll write that down and. Yes, well, prayers for all who need it. Yeah. So, anyway, like I said, if you think of anything later on, let us know, and we'll definitely just, you know, add you to the prayer list. And always, you know, like feedback on how things are going. Let me see. I'm not seeing any. I think I missed any. I think I got them all. Got Tina, Russ, all who need it, and I'm trying to think of anything else. Yeah, anyway, let me know if anybody ever has any questions about Ithaca, or if you're like interested in going or visiting. It kind of reminds me a little bit about Berkeley when I got out here, because it's very much of a college town, but a lot of professors and a lot of very intellectual type hippies, I guess you would kind of say. So yeah, it's a very eclectic area, and I haven't been back, honestly. I haven't been back probably in 20 years or so. So I think a lot has probably changed since I've been back. Has it even been that long? Maybe it's been, yeah, it's probably, I haven't been back there since I've known you, have I? So it's been at least 15 or 20 years since I've been back there. But definitely probably a better place to visit in the summer than in the winter. And it's kind of close to where Tina lives. Not super close, but in the vicinity where she lives. It's glad to hear that that's helped you. We were just talking about what a great community this is, and how the people can be very supportive of each other. So we really embrace that. And
good night, Dennis.
No, I know Ithaca. I know lots about Disneyland, Russ. It's just my mind sometimes isn't working. On the road trip, I got some delicious. Oh, you got tomatoes from a real farm stand. Always remember that. And oh, nobody could remember where it was. Well, you know what else is great in that area? Not just Ithaca, but in like the whole Finger Lakes area, is the corn. That's the other thing that I remember. Corn season, you know, was like in July, I think. And oh, the sweet corn. It was like so fresh right off the cob. We would just go get it at the farm. And they would just leave it out on the side of the road, and you would just go and stick your dollar. I think I've told that story before. You would just go put your money, a dollar, in the bin, and then take a bag of corn. And it was the farmer's dozen, so I don't know. It was like 14 ears of corn for a dollar. Here you pay $2 and you get one ear of corn. Kid you not. It's crazy. So, anyway, you just got your first snowfall. Oh, nice. Well, we're getting a lot of snow here. So anyway, it's been real. It's getting late. We had fun making pizza. If you guys missed our earlier stream for the healthy pizza, go check it out because it wasn't half bad. If you're looking for something healthy to make and, you know, looking for ideas.
Okay,
music. Oh, you're going to play. Garrett will continue on with the late stream for a little bit. And then this other pizza was pretty good too. I don't think I'm a fan of the thin crust, but that's why it's healthy, because you don't get a lot of calories that way. So anyway, have a great night, you guys. Thanks to the moderators. You do a great job. We love you, appreciate you. And we'll see you guys in the chat over the weekend. And we'll post something on Sunday one way or the other, so you'll know what's going on. Okay? We'll see you real soon. Bye, guys.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your you. I can only imagine. It's always done. Get up, go to work, start the day. You open up for business, it's never gonna come. As the world rolls by a million miles away.
Traffic lights. And I really wanna know if I'll ever figure out where the road goes. Even if I'm...
Almost believing this one's not pretending about your I close my eyes and I can see a world that's waiting up for me, that I call my own. Through the dark, through the door, through where no one's been before, but it feels like home. They can say it all sounds crazy. They can say I've lost my mind. I don't care if they call me crazy. We can live in a world that we desire.
We didn't care what we were told, 'cause when we were younger, we used to sit on the grass and go, damn, I don't wanna grow old. I wish I could turn back time.
Stay up all night singing songs on the terrace. We didn't mind sitting out in the cold.
possible to make us embarrassed. We were free. Do you remember stealing smokes from your parents? Sometimes we got a bit out of control. When they found out we ran from home just to scare them, we were free. When we were 17. When we got older, we tried to stay in touch. But we had to move on. Life ran away from us. If I could go back, be 17 again, yeah, I would, just to see all my friends running around the city, acting crazy like we used to do. I wish I could turn back time. Stay up all night singing songs on the terrace. We didn't mind sitting out in the cold. It wasn't possible to make us embarrassed. We were free.